This film is about Howard Wakefield, who goes through sort of a breakdown on a whim and decides to abandon his family, which is me and my twin sister and Jennifer Garner. And he lives in the attic that's detached and on top of our garage, and he just peers in through the window and watches us live on for months on end and continue life without him. And it's sort of about his sociopathic view on life. And it's just a great piece of cinema. I think he was born with an incredible talent. I was able to sit with him on set for a while and just talk about acting. And I think behind it all, it's just the passion that you have for the craft. I mean, some people are meant to sit at a desk from 9 to 5 and they love what they do. And I guess some people hate it. And some people are meant to use their talent for the world, and their talent is acting. So I'm grateful that he found out that that's what his passion was and that he pursued it and is where he is at now, because he's such a great role model. So I don't know. I think it's just the spirit within him. We had a shadow script, which was completely separate from the actual script. So Howard views us and our family moments from afar, and it's primarily his narration over it all. And what we're acting inside, we had scripts for, and we had scenes written out for by Robin. So preparing for those and having fun rehearsing with those and just discussing who we are in our actual lives, and using bits and pieces of ourselves to bring that together into this little family that we created, was really helpful. Yeah. It's incredibly important to have that relationship with your director, just so you feel comfortable, so you feel like you're in great hands. I trusted her completely with whether it was how I looked or what she wanted from the scene, or if she was going to give me a piece of advice or tell me to go a little more or go a little less or something. So I don't know if I just lucked out with working with her. I'm fairly new to this industry. But I think it's one of the most important things, aside from the script and aside from the other actors involved. If you don't have that connection with your director, I imagine it would be very difficult. We had a 20-day shoot, but we had a two-week holiday break in between, so it was kind of split up. And after I wrapped, I actually came back for the following week, where Brian had all of his scenes in the attic, and I was just, Robin hooked me up with a monitor and a headset, and I was just there with my notebook taking notes on just Brian and acting and being on set. So that kind of, I don't know, felt like I was outside of myself, so maybe it felt like it was a longer shoot, but everybody was just really on top of it and on top of the schedule, and if something didn't work and we had to move on, we just moved on and we made it work. I have a role in 20th Century Woman, which is premiering at the New York Film Festival in just about a month or so. And then mid-October, I start working on a film called Under the Silver Lake, directed by David Robert Mitchell, and Andrew Garfield and Dakota Johnson are in that.
I wrote music, as I'm telling everybody, which is the truth, which is I was writing thematic music that was tuneful, and also the harmonies are very, very kind of like something that would be out of a film from the late 50s, early 60s, you know, maybe all the way up to the early 70s. And that, to me, is like where you can really draw from very sophisticated harmony. And in fact, when the opening 4-minute segment of the film, that piece of music that comes right on Robin Swycourt's directorial name is very Ravelian. It almost feels like I did it on purpose. It feels kind of like a Ravelish quality to it. So impressionistic, if you will. And then I was very careful not to tread over the narratives with Brian, because what he's saying and what he's doing is so important that the music had to support the picture. So there's propulsiveness, there's deep harmony, there's memorable melody, and it's one of those scores that if I'm asked to just write a score that's in this style, I'm like kid in the candy store. You know, the story is like, how could somebody do this to their wife, like to their significant other? Well, people have done this for centuries. The thing is in the days of, I think, our parents, in the days of you know, little more olden times, families stuck together because they stuck together. These days, it's we live in a different generation, different world. And a lot of people grow up with fathers that abandon them early. My father was abandoned at 1 year old. He was an orphan and was moved in foster homes all over the place. So I have a connection to this. But as the film evolves, so does Brian. So does Howard Wakefield. Wakefield becomes the man that he was supposed to be because of what he did. So without the cause and effect, and without the beginning of what happens, you can't, whether you like him or not in the beginning is a total subjective choice. You know, most often not. In the first quarter of the film, you'll make your own assumptions. But as we get close to the middle and to the third and fourth and final act, you start to realize that this man has gone through a metamorphosis that is like us all through life. If you don't change and evolve in life and you stay stagnant your whole life and you don't grow, then the journey, I guess, is not as prevalent as it would be if somebody that does grow. And if had he never did what he did, he would have stayed just that Howard Wakefield. He left himself. He left his family, but at the same time, he learned to have more of an appreciation from being afar. And then we watch him slowly trying to reintegrate in his own way. And then he discovers things about himself that he never knew. And that's what musically I try to help support. The thing that makes Brian, well, first of all, Brian is an astonishing talent, as we all know. And he has no limit to what he can't do. And this film proves it, because he's doing the narratives, and he's having, in a way, having to pantomime what these narratives are. And that's an art of a brilliant actor. I mean, there's not too many actors that can be the narrative behind the actual guy actually physically carrying out the assignment, to be able to show us the sides that may make us uncomfortable, and then show us the sides that may bring a tear. And he brings such a range of emotion, not just by what he says, but what he does, what he doesn't say. And also there's just certain looks and certain what they captured from him visually on screen. I always, whenever I tell anybody, and I've spoken to Brian about this, there was one pinnacle point in the film because I went to set a lot in the beginning, and for the first 8 days of the shoot, and there was and behind the monitor there was a look that he had that just told it all. So he brings so much to the table, and like I said, this is a tough film to a tough assignment for any actor to carry out. So just my respect level for him, not only going into the vortex, but completing this vortex with such a brilliant tour de force performance. I mean, I've never seen anything like it, as far as, you know, not conventional lines. So there's nothing conventional about this film at all.
For some reason, E.L. Doctorow's story just hooked me. That universal thing of wanting to be in the family, but wanting to be out of the family. Wanting to be safe and secure and in your daily life, and also to escape your daily life. I feel like that's a really universal emotion. And so I wanted to explore that. He was such a complex character. He starts off kind of unsympathetic. We're not really on his side that much. And then as we go along, he becomes more and more interesting, and I began to get fascinated with him. And I was really trying to solve my problem of why would a man do this? In order to make the film, you know, that was kind of the impetus of it. I always knew that Bryan Cranston was going to be a fabulous Howard Wakefield. It took a little while for him to become available and for us to make that happen, but I just kind of kept holding on to that idea of him. He has that perversity, that humor, and he also has the pathos of this character. Jennifer was the super bonus because she came onto the movie kind of late, and she was exactly who I was looking for. Her authenticity, her vulnerability, the fact that you could see her from a distance and tell what she's thinking She was so perfect for this, and she gave herself completely to the role, in a way, egoless. So there are actors who wouldn't have taken the role because she doesn't have the chance to speak that much. She's being observed through a window. But Jennifer really saw that as an acting challenge that she wanted to take. I started working on the screenplay in 2012, January 2012. By, I would say, May or so, I had a draft that felt pretty strong. And we started going out to financiers initially to try and see whether we could get some traction just on the material itself. It took about 4 years because part of that time we were waiting for Brian to become available because he had lined up a lot of work. He likes to work. He's a great actor. He gets offered a lot. And so it took us about 4 years altogether before we were in production. It's been a year since then that we, you know, it took us a year to make the movie.
We filmed it so quickly, I don't even remember. But you just act the scenes, you know, the scenes. Luckily, Robin Swycord had written me a shadow script that you never hear me perform, but we did memorize and play as if we were doing that for, you know, as if that was the movie. And we loved it.
What drew you to the script?
Brian and Robin's writing. It's really beautifully written. I love good writing. Even though I don't get to say it, I still love it.
It all starts with the writing. Robin Swycord is a beautiful visionary of a writer. And a sister relationship to that is directing. And she masterfully handles that and very sensitive. I love working with women. There is an innate sensibility that is very emotional. Not that men can't be emotional, but you almost embrace that sensibility with women, and it's great. And it was very much a collaboration. When isn't there a time I want to escape? Right now. Look at all these microphones here. It's a little abnormal, right? It's like with these microphones here, and I'm expected to speak on this. And I love it. I love the story of Wakefield because it's a story that I think resonates with everybody, male or female, that at some point, haven't we had enough? Aren't we all addicted to our technology and our phones? When we're alone, don't we automatically go to it? And don't you recognize that? You go, oh my God, can I not be alone for a second? Can I not just look at a tree or a bird? Do I have to constantly be on this thing so that I try to catch up to what is expected of me? And there's something to that of society that demands more production and more production. I know you're all feeling that. You've all been there. And it's like at times you want to just exhale and put the phone down and allow yourself to be a human being again. And that's what Howard Wakefield does in a very interesting way. And he has a very difficult time in reintroducing himself to the real world. You know, all I had to do in preparing for this role is to imagine my own world and the world that our society lives in, that we are driven, work-oriented, driven society, which is commendable in many ways. And yet, we could get addicted to that because of our own expectations, not to mention our bosses, but our own. And at some time, you just have to be able to say, I am not using this tool correctly. I need to just put it down and be able to be the master of that tool and not have it master me.